Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your word that's truth. Holy Spirit, move in this place now. Move in this place. Have your way in my life. Speak through me, Lord. Speak through me, Holy Spirit. Have your way. Father, I thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. I thank you for that resurrection power that came through Jesus. Father, may your word be revealed tonight to your glory, to your praise, and in the power of the Holy Spirit. And we give much thanks for this word, this of the Holy Spirit that brings restoration to our lives, brings strength to our lives, brings encouragement to our lives. And we give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Tonight we're looking at the Holy Spirit, fire and power. Initiating the relationship. Romans 5, verses 6 through 14, and I'm going to read from the Amplified Bible, says this: Now the mind of the flesh, which is the sense and reasoning part of us, without the Holy Spirit, is death. Death that comprises all the miseries arising from sin, both here and hereafter. But the mind of the Holy Spirit is life and soul peace, both now and forever. That is because the mind of the flesh, with its carnal thoughts and purposes, is hostile to God. For it does not submit itself to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. So verse 8 says this: Those who are living the life of the flesh, catering to the appetites and impulses of their carnal nature, cannot please or satisfy God or be acceptable to him. I paused on that for a moment because I thought of this catering to our appetites and those things that lead to the sinful nature. Is a table prepared for the sinful nature? Well, I'm sure there's a table set just like Jesus prepared a table for us in the presence of our enemies. And those enemies are anything that has to do with the carnal nature. But God set a table that is at the cross of Jesus. Verse 9 says this: But you are not living the life of the flesh. You are living the life of the Spirit if the Holy Spirit of God really dwells within you, directs you, and controls you. But if anyone does not possess the Holy Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. He does not belong to Christ, is not truly a child of God. Verse 10, but if Christ lives in you, then although your natural body is dead by reason of sin and guilt, the Spirit is alive. It's alive because of the righteousness that God himself imputes into us once we receive Jesus as Lord. And verse 11, and if the Spirit of him who raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, then he who raised up Christ Jesus from the dead will also restore to life your mortal, short-lived, perishable bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. So the Holy Spirit came when we received Jesus. He has come that we have restoration in our lives, restoration of what the enemy has stolen, either from your life by sickness or disease, by something someone else caused, maybe a drunk driver, maybe there's something missing in your marriage, maybe there's something missing in your relationship with your children, and Jesus died on the cross to bring that restoration. Amen. Through his death, we gained the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so then it says here, verse 12, so then, brethren, we are debtors, but not to the flesh. We are not obligated to our carnal nature to live a life ruled by the standards set up by those dictates of the flesh. For if you live according to those, you surely die. But if through the power of the Holy Spirit, you are habitually, every day, putting to death those things that would rise up as a sin in you, if you're putting it to death, and I like what it says here, making extinct deadening. If it's making it extinct, then it doesn't exist anymore, like dinosaurs. They don't exist anymore. So if we're making those things extinct in our lives, then they're not going to be there anymore. You won't see them anymore. And it's deadening those evil deeds prompted by the body. Then when we've done that, you will really and genuinely live forever. Verse 14, for all who are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. And that's what God wanted, was a family. He wanted a family. And Jesus came that we would have salvation and that we would have this marvelous Godhead, the Holy Spirit, come and reside in us, outside of us, to prompt us, to lead us. And the Holy Spirit always leads by gentleness. He is a gentle dove. And we'll talk more about that. So in this resurrection, the Holy Spirit came. John 20, verses 8 through 10, is a verse I wanted to point us to. Then the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away again to their own homes. And then Acts 2, it says this. This is Peter speaking on the sermon after they have received Pentecost. They received the prayer of the Holy Spirit came in them with power. And he's speaking to this group that was down below at the time and speaking in different languages. And he says this to them. In verse 25, for David says concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face. For he is at my right hand that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart rejoiced and my tongue was glad. Moreover, my flesh will also rest in hope. For you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of joy in your presence. Now Peter was reciting what David, as the prophet, saw who was coming through his lineage, that it would be this Jesus, Jesus the Christ, Jesus the Anointed One, and Peter is making point to here to exclaim to them, this is why this has happened. That's why there's Pentecost. That's why the Holy Spirit came, and there was that power to pray in tongues. It's praying in tongues, and it's to move in power. It's allowing our tongues to be loosed by the Holy Spirit to allow Him to pray through us through situations that we need to know. Pray for things that we don't even know is in front of us. And so it's to give us power and to arm us with that which we need. And then he goes on to say this in verse 30 to 33. Again, this is Peter in that sermon from Acts 2. Therefore, being a prophet and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his body, according to the flesh, he would raise up the Christ to sit on his throne. He, foreseeing this, spoke concerning the resurrection of the Christ, that his soul would not be left in Hades, nor that his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God has raised up, of which we are all witnesses. And verse 33, therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this which you now see and hear. So understand, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, other people are going to see it and they're going to hear it. Whatever God is doing, it's going to be about God. It's going to bring glory to God. It's going to be in power. And people are going to see that there's a difference. They're not going to want to hang back and be the last one behind. They're going to want to join you. They want to be a part of what God is doing. So Peter was talking to this group that was right after Pentecost, when they had gathered in the upper room. And with those 120, they were all filled as the Holy Spirit came in like this mighty wind. He came in like this mighty wind, and he filled them with power. And so it is by this power that the word of God goes out. Paul spoke this to a group in Antioch. This is found in Acts 13, verses 26 to 32, and it's the New King James Version. Men and brethren, sons of the family of Abraham, and those among you who fear God, to you the word of this salvation has been sent out for those who dwell in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not know him, nor even the voices. This is Paul saying of these rulers, these people in Jerusalem, they did not know Jesus, nor even the voices of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath, have fulfilled them in condemning him. So they were condemning Jesus, even though the prophets from of old were read in their synagogues, yet these people that were standing there in Jerusalem at that time was condemning Jesus. They were sending him to the cross. And so he goes on to say in verse 28, and though they found no cause for death in him, they asked Pilate that he should be put to death. Verse 29, now when they had fulfilled all that was written concerning him, they took him down from the tree and they laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead. He was seen for many days by those who came with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses to the people. And we declare to you glad tidings that promise which was made to the fathers, God has fulfilled this for us, their children, in that he has raised up Jesus. As it is written in the second Psalm, you are my son, today I have begotten you. So Paul was even restating what was taken from the prophets. He was restating what David had put in the Psalms. And so the Holy Spirit, he imparts to us spiritual truth, John 14, 26. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I've said to you. The Lord will always tell you. He will direct you by his word. When the word is being given like this from the word of God, he'll prompt you by something he's taught you. And we have to obey that specific word. We have to move when the Holy Spirit gives us something. We can't hesitate. John 16, 13, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. And he will not speak of his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak and will tell you things to come. It's that still small voice. He tells you the things that God will speak. And it comes from the authority of God himself. So when the Holy Spirit, who is God, comes upon you, you're going to have authority. Amen. Imparts us with his power to proclaim Jesus and his resurrection. Of course, Acts 1, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the earth. So this was for power in ministry. Fills believers with this power, Acts 2, 4, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Amen. It's the Holy Spirit's always ready to pray through me. Am I ready to open my mouth? You know, am I wanting to do other things? And then the Holy Spirit pours out God's love into our hearts, Romans 5, 5. Now hope does not disappoint. The love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, who was given to us. And so when we allow the Holy Spirit to be here and continue filling us with that love of God, then that love should be pouring out. That should be a river. It shouldn't be a dry area where you feel like you got a canoe and you got to carry the canoe down, you know, because it's a riverbed. It's no longer the actual river. But we're supposed to have that relationship with God, and it's supposed to be this river that's moving through continually, praying in tongues. It's reading the Word of God. It's praying just, you know, with your regular language, in, you know, regular words that you do know. And then this, to walk in holiness, Romans 8. This is verses 1 through 8. This is in the New King James Version. The Holy Spirit helps us to walk in that holiness. There is therefore now no condemnation. Now listen, there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. But for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made us free, free from that law of sin and death. So it's in Christ Jesus. It's not in your pastor. It's not in your best friend. It's that Spirit of life that's in Christ Jesus. And so it has to be through salvation. It has to be confessing Jesus as Lord of your life. It's not going to come any other way. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own son in the likeness of that sinful flesh on account of sin. He condemned sin in this flesh, verse 4, that the righteous requirement, a righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So we have this righteousness, and it's required. God requires us to be righteous, in right standing with Him. So it's that holiness. It's imputed to us. It's imputed by the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Verse 5, for those who live according to the flesh set their minds on things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, they are the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. And people are looking for peace today, and they can't seem to find it. Well, stay in God, because you're not going to find it in the next march down the street. You won't find it, you know, in the bar. You won't find it down there, you know, in the corner. But you will find it in that prayer room with God. You will ask God, and He will bring you His peace. When you seek His face, to abide in Him, ask His Holy Spirit to come. Amen. And then imparts gifts or ministry. 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 11. This is in the New King James Version. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. So the same Spirit, Holy Spirit, does these things. There are different ministries, but the same Lord. There are diversities of activities, but the same God. The manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For to one is given the word of wisdom, to another is given the word of knowledge, and through another, but it's still the same Spirit, to another the gift of faith. That's verse 9, by the same Spirit. And then to another the gifts of healings by the same Holy Spirit. Right. Verse 10, to another the working of miracles. You might be in an area where praying in tongues, and God will lead you to be in a place where this miracle is just done. You just lean over, pray for someone, and they're, you know, maybe their arm grows back out. Maybe they lost it, you know, in Desert Storm. Maybe you know, God is wanting you to move in, go through the mall or something, and talk to someone and lay hands on someone to see them recover their sight. So that you can see these gifts of healings. It's still the same Holy Spirit. And then this one, to another a prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, and then an interpretation of tongues. So everyone can pray in tongues, but there's like these diversities of tongues. Each can receive their prayer language. I have mine, my husband has his, you know, and our children all have theirs. And so mine sounds like Mandarin Chinese. It's all, you know, and I'm not sure what my husband is, but I know mine's kind of, because the sounds that it makes reminds me of when I'm listening to people who speak, you know, Mandarin. And so with each of these receiving this, it's the same Spirit who works all these things, distributing to each one individually as the Holy Spirit wills. Well, do we spend time with the Holy Spirit? Do we say, you know, we loose you now into our lives, into these situations? Or do you, keep the door closed to the Holy Spirit? Well, that's why Jesus was resurrected. He was resurrected by a resurrection of power that came through the Holy Spirit. And then we can have that same resurrection power working in our lives. And the first time I got a revelation of this was by the Holy Spirit. My husband and I had moved to the Northwest some 20 years ago. And it had been a dream to have our own business. And my husband was going to different plants, dams and such, to show him these things that we could do with management for maintenance on their equipment. And so one of the dams that was north and kind of east of the Seattle area invited us out to go on a tour. And while we were there, they were going to turn on the turbines. And it was really exciting in that we could see this row of turbines, and there was a walkway that would take you to the river where the water would pour through. And there was a wall where they didn't want to lose you over, you know, that wall. So it was high enough, but still I could look over it. But we were there by the turbines when they turned them on, and I could just feel the vibration. I mean, it was like da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. I mean, it was like the vibration under your feet with all these turbines, and you could just feel the force of the water. And as I was experiencing that and walking towards the wall, because the man, I couldn't hear him, his voice, you know, his lips were moving. The turbines were so loud on both sides of me. And so I was walking towards their direction, and I could just feel the vibration of my feet. And I heard the Holy Spirit say, "This is my power. This is what you experience when you pray in tongues and I release you into a situation. When I have you pray for someone, this is the power. It's like that water that's flowing through those turbines. It's that kind of power. It vibrates. It terrifies the devil and his cohorts." And so I've taken that with me these 20 years. I've taken that with me. And I know that when I pray in tongues, then I'm destroying the works of the enemy. I'm destroying the works of the devil. So understand, this is a power ministry as well. Each display the powerful Holy Spirit given to every believer. It is for the body believers, and it's the manifestations of God's work in and through us. It is allowing the Holy Spirit to work through us. These are not earned. You don't earn these. I'm no more mature than any. It's not about maturity. Is what I'm trying to say. It's not about how old you are, but it's more about how the Holy Spirit is allowed to work through you. Are you available? You know, are you set to say, "Holy Spirit, have your way. Come on, move through this place," or do you just want to shut him down and have no flow of river, no flowing life of God, that river of life to flow through either your church, maybe your Bible study, maybe your home. You know, I don't know what the situation, but it's those that are available and are willing to serve others, to go pray for others. That's when the Holy Spirit is there, and he'll just come upon you. You'll just move in power of the Holy Spirit. And then the Holy Spirit strengthens our inner man. Ephesians 3, verses 13 through 15. "Therefore I ask you that you do not lose heart at my tribulations for you, which is your glory. For this reason I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from heaven the whole family in heaven and earth is named." Can you imagine? Verse 15, "From heaven the whole family in heaven and earth is named after the Lord Jesus Christ, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in your inner man." That spirit man standing up, being moved, propelled by God. He inspires the writings of the scriptures, 2 Timothy 3, 16 through 17. We looked at this last night. "All scripture is given by inspiration of God, is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness." God wants us to be taught in his righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. And then 2 Peter 1, verse 20 and 21. "Knowing this first, that no prophecy or scripture is of any private interpretation, for prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit." The above that we've just read always enforces God's word, aligns us with a clear teaching and complete. Where by is our faith then strengthened. We're, our faith is growing in God. Our righteousness is evidence when we're building others. We're reaching to pray for others. It's not about us hiding in the corner or hanging back and coming and being the last one at church, but the first one to leave. Not hiding over there in the dark corner, but staying in the light, staying in the presence of God, willing to do that and speak that truth and to declare the glory of God and what He has done for each of us in restoring us, because our lives speak of restoration. Right. My husband and I, we both have restoration. Amen. Of things that have been restored that the devil tried to destroy. Right. Or bring down in our lives, but God has restored so many things. To baptize with the Holy Spirit and fire, Luke 3, this is verse 15 through 18, as people were in suspense and waiting expectantly, and everybody reasoned and questioned in their hearts concerning John, whether he perhaps might be the Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One. John answered them all by saying, I baptize you with water, but he who is mightier than I is coming, the strap of whose sandals I am not fit to unfasten. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. And I had always, you know, thought about this. I was always looking at this because it just like, okay, why would he need to say it twice? Yeah. If we already know the Holy Spirit's fire, then why does he have to talk about the fire? So actually, as you get to looking at it, there's actually two fires. There's the Holy Spirit fire, but there's also another fire if you reject the Holy Spirit fire. If you're rejecting Jesus, then you won't get this first Holy Spirit fire. You won't get the gentle dove. You won't get that gentleman who's, you know, walks you through those situations. You'll end up at the other place where it is fire. So he says here, verse 17, his winnowing shovel, which is the fork, is in his hand to thoroughly clear and cleanse his threshing floor and to gather the wheat and store it in his granary. But the chaff he will burn with a fire that cannot be extinguished. Luke 9, this is 49 through 56, New King James. John said, Master, we saw a man driving out demons in your name. And we commanded him to stop it, for he does not follow along with us. But Jesus told him, do not forbid such people, for whoever is not against you is for you. Because they may not be in the same group that you're on in, but they, you know, they're, if they're casting them out and people are being saved, And then it says here, do not forbid such people. Verse 51, now when the time was almost come for Jesus to be received up into heaven, he steadfastly and determinedly set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers before him, and they reached and entered a Samaritan village to make things ready. But the people would not welcome or receive or accept him because his face was set as if he was going to Jerusalem. And when his disciples, James and John, observed this, they said, Lord, do you wish us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elijah did? That's a fire, that's a judgment fire. That they're talking about from Elijah and was from 2 Kings. It was Elijah, you know, rebuilding the altar, and Jezebel had her false prophets up there, and they numbered, you know, what was it? I don't remember the number, 250 or something. It was a large number. Maybe it was 400, but it was a large number of false prophets that were always speaking false against God, but to lift her up and make her look good. Elijah went on Mount Carmel and he rebuilt the altar, and he called fire down from heaven, but God wasn't going to do this through Jesus. Jesus was going to be as the sacrifice that would be laying on that altar that's being built. And God saw that altar was being built, and he had Jesus as a sacrifice, so there wouldn't be that fire. People have the opportunity to receive a Savior. They have that every day. And if the Holy Spirit comes on them to say, okay, now's the day of salvation, and they reject him, I think the Holy Spirit will just come so many times and then, Verse 55, but he turned and rebuked and severely censured them. He said, you do not know what sort of spirit you are, because they were wanting fire to come down on these people. But Jesus knew how they felt, and he was set to go do something anyway. He was already set to obey what his Father told him to do, but he already knew these people's hearts. They saw Jesus, oh, that's Mary's son. Oh, Joseph and Mary, that, the carpenters, right? They're the carpenters. You know, he's just, you know, he's ordinary Joe. But other people knew Jesus as Jesus Christ, the anointed. Amen. And so, verse 56, for the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them from the penalty of eternal death. And they journeyed on to another village. So Jesus came with the Holy Spirit, who is gentle. Now Jesus by himself, people would see him, again, Joseph and Mary's son. Oh, yeah, the carpenter's son. Others would know him as of power by the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit people would know Jesus as the Son of Man, the Son of God, convicted the religious man, the one working against God. He was convicting any of those that were, you know, living by the law, because they were setting up this different kingdom, the kingdom of heaven. And so the suffering Messiah would die for many, be resurrected, and be seated at the right hand of God. Again, there's two fires. Jesus baptized with the Holy Spirit, that is the gentle dove. He will return with fire. He came at Pentecost and continues today. It deals with people with these fruits. When we have the Holy Spirit, we should see these fruits. Now, the Holy Spirit doesn't have the fruits. He's the Holy Spirit. We're the ones that should have the fruit. We should have the fruit of love and joy and peace, long-suffering. If you saw how we prepared for tonight, each of us needed some long suffering, long patience, being long on, you know, getting to where you could get to point B. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, against such there is no law. And those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh with its passions and its desires. Well, we know those that are not of Christ, they'll get angry, they'll throw things, they'll get upset, you know, just speak the strangest things, and thinking, you know, why are they doing that? Verse 25, if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. So to have the Spirit of God is to have the same that Jesus had. Our conduct is how our character will react in any situations or problems. Our power is to be the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. Remember, as I told you, the Holy Spirit was showing me, it's like the power of that rushing water that's going through all those turbines and it's going through to produce electricity. It's a lot of water. It's a lot of power. So then we look at the second fire. The first fire is by the Holy Spirit, because Jesus came to give us the Holy Spirit. He left us his comforter. But here we see another. This would be the second. It is the second fire that's found in the second death, Revelation 20, 11 through 15. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, whose face the earth and heaven fled away. Yikes. So the heaven and earth are not there anymore, and there's a throne there, and there's a God sitting on it, but the earth and heaven have fled away because of him who sat on the throne, whose face scared them. And there was found not place for them, and I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God. Now remember, this is John. He wrote this, but it was given to him by Jesus, the Revelator. And standing before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. Verse 14, then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. A formality? True. It's written for our benefit, for us to see. But God desires to check in this book of life to make sure there are no believers in this judgment, because there is a judgment there where people are standing in midair. Heaven and earth, this what he's talking about, have fled away. So this is a judgment where these people are going to the second death. They've died the first time. Right. All people are appointed once to die, and then the judgment. Scripture says that.
Right.
And so he wants to make certain that a believer in this midst of the people before him, God himself, would not continue specifically in the second death if they had believed on Jesus. And so he's got his book, but he's also checking to make sure from the book of life, if there's any, is there one? Is there one? And then he closes the book. So it is for those who rejected Jesus, the Christ, Jesus, the anointed one, God's anointed son who proclaimed life through his death and, yes, his resurrection, and sent his Holy Spirit, the Comforter, to comfort us. Go read John 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17. Go read where he talks about the Comforter, who he was sending. Yes, the Holy Spirit is the love of God revealed. He is never pushy. Never demanding. The Holy Spirit is always a gentleman, very polite, and he will always lead us. He will take us by the hand, oh, ever so gently. He'll lead you through trials. He'll lead you through tribulations, whatever adversity, whatever wind is blowing, he can be there with you. But in this last venture, this of what they call the second death, no Holy Spirit, time's up. Believe today while it's called today. Believe. Conduct your life in knowing he's coming back. Abide in the spiritual of the Holy Spirit. Abide in his power. Never adopt the world's way of thinking and doing. Always reject the world's behavior. Keep seeking that relationship with God. Stay within the boundary of his word. Keep your ear open to hear the Holy Spirit speak, and keep looking for restoration in your life and the return of the Lord Jesus Christ, for he is coming back soon. In closing, will he find faith on the earth? Luke 18, verse 6. Then the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said. And shall God not avenge his own elect who cry out day and night to him through, though he bears long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? Jesus was talking about the church people. He was talking to those of the faith. Will he find faith on the earth? He did not speak to them all, but those who truly followed him. Those who needed a touch from Jesus, they reached out either by word or within themselves to touch his truth. In Jesus, we know that he kept the works his Father told him to do. The priority was always having the presence of God. I hope you experienced the presence of God in this tonight. God is living, and he's loves us. He desires us to be with him always. In his actions, Jesus was the Son of Mary, but in power he was, is, and will always be the Son of the Father, the righteous King who brought salvation to the world. Jesus brought God's kingdom and God's authority, and by the Holy Spirit we have the same power. Now go in his power and his presence, submit to his plan, and discover the blessing of heaven on earth. Amen. Hallelujah.